deal with really sophisticated data drunk.
Yeah.
And the Tamarine, I forgot that. But the point is that it was liberating. Liberation comes in another form when we tell you about salaries and work. When we think about airplanes and being able, so many of you all, traveling clear across this country to be here today, that's transportation. When you think about the clothes that you have on, tonight when you're hanging them up, look at the labels. They came over here on a boat, I guarantee you. 99% of the clothes in this room came over here on a boat. They were liberated from China. And Bangladesh. I'm serious, y'all do that. Do that little thing for me. When y'all hanging up your clothes, just look at the label and think about what I said. But it is truly, transportation truly is a civil right. And we saw something not long ago in Baltimore that really made it all come crystal clear. For over 10 years, people in Baltimore had come together to work on a red line project. And we had people, black, white, Hispanic, Latina, coming from all over the city searching for liberation. They wanted to have a quicker way to get from one side of town to the other, that's all. To be able to get to the jobs, to be able to get to school, to be able to get to work, to be able to get to church, liberation. And we had a Republican governor that came in after those people worked all those years, and after we had this phenomenal support and encouragement of Secretary Fox and our Department of Transportation and so many others. And after we've done all that work, and I myself have sat in at least 40 or 50 meetings over those years, people had never talked to each other. They were being liberated, of course, because now they were interacting with each other. People from on one side of the railroad track and the other coming together, seeking what? Liberation. And so we had a Republican governor that came in and said, no, I'm not doing it. And we had to turn away 900, it hurts my heart to even say it, $900 million plus. But that was not all of it. And I know Secretary Fox will maybe talk about this a little bit. But we knew that there would be a lot of jobs that would come to Baltimore, particularly after our services, and all around all those stops where the red line would have stopped. And not only that, the construction of it. And it would have lifted up our city for generations. So what am I saying? Y'all better vote. I know. There's somebody in here thinking about Trump. I'm talking about voting for him. Ladies and gentlemen, listen to me. I beg you, not on my behalf, because I'll be dead when the full impact of a Trump is felt. I'll be dead. But just the appointment of Supreme Court justices alone, I don't care how many times you go to that Flint church and get married. I don't care how many times he goes, wherever he goes. The fact is that we are seeking liberation. I'm not going back. And I don't want my children to go back. And I don't want my children's children to go back. Nor do I want them fighting the same fights that I've been fighting. So it gives me great honor to again thank you, because you're the liberators. You're the ones who have to fight. You're the leaders. Everybody in this room is a leader. Go on, look to your left, look to your right. Throw on some teeth now. Everybody in this, can I tell you why you're a leader? How many of you all, and then I'm ready for you, it's like, don't go nowhere, It's your stage. Anyway, how many in here, in this room, how many of you all had at least three or four people around election time to come and ask you, who should they vote for? Come on. I ain't by myself. I got about 7. I gave you a list. My point is that you influence a lot of votes. People know that you are the ones that go to the community meetings. Hello? You're the ones that read the newspaper and the internet. They know, they see you as a leader. They see you as being informed. And what I'm saying to you is use your influence. The reason why I mentioned the red line in Baltimore is it shows who is at the top makes a difference.
Right.
Leadership makes a difference. So I want to introduce to you a great man. Former mayor, and one who has consistently synchronized his conscience with his conduct. Over and over and over again, I cannot remember one time where I have called on him when he was not there. He may not have been able to deliver all that I would want, but I want a lot. And I have high expectations. But he has never, I can say it, he has never let us down in my city. He has never let me down, and he has never let our nation down. And I have watched him go all over this country, lifting up transportation and making sure that there is equity and parity throughout our nation. And so I'm going to be in and out today. I'm going to be in and out. And by the way, all our panelists, I want to thank all of you for participating. But now, please welcome the Secretary of Transportation for the United States of America, Secretary Fox.
Thank you very much. If this were a church, I would say that you just heard a sermon, and now it's going to sound like you're talking to the church bookkeeper. let me just say that, Congressman Cummings, you know who Congressman Cummings is. You know what he believes because he acts on his beliefs. And I'm so grateful to him for many reasons. One of the reasons I will share with you is that back in the late 1990s, I was a staffer on Capitol Hill working for Congressman Mel Watts. And in 2001, I went back home to North Carolina, and in the summer of 2003, I believe it was, the CBC Institute created a training program for young people to get involved in campaigns. And I remember going to Morgan State for and we got an incredible set of presentations about how to put campaigns together, how to run for office. And so I was able, based on that experience, the next election cycle, Congressman White called me and asked me to run his campaign, and we did, and he won overwhelmingly, not because of me, but because of him. But then in 2005, I started running for local elected office, and I tied my political successes to this institute, so I want to thank you. I wouldn't be standing here without the great leadership of Congressman Cummings. Brad, congratulations. looking forward to working with you and the entire team at Compto at the U.S. Department of Transportation. I'm going to be fairly brief today in what I have to say, but I hopefully it will be impactful. Transportation is a civil right. It is a civil right. And if you look back at the history of our transportation system, it hasn't always served everybody equally or fairly. I remember looking at a flyer from back in Montgomery, Alabama in 1955, where a community came together because the bus system in Montgomery imposed a segregated seating arrangement where black folks were expected to get up if the bus got full and somebody white got on it. Otherwise, if there were seats, they were to sit in the back. And I remember seeing this flyer saying that on a certain appointed date, folks were to not get on the buses. And if you think about it, a community back in 1955 in Montgomery, for more than a year, people who worked in homes, solitary people, didn't use the public transit system for an entire year until Montgomery yielded and tore down that wall that existed on those buses, and they won. And out of that came a little preacher, Martin Luther King Jr., who helped this entire country start to see itself with fresh eyes. So my point is that our transportation system and the connection to civil rights has always been there. But let me talk to you a little bit about some of our modern day challenges. You hear a lot today about the fact that our infrastructure is aging, it's getting past its useful life, we're not investing enough. But if you peer into any city in this country and you look at the alignment of our highway system, what is also clear is that when that system invariably was designed, in many cases it was designed to run right through strong minority communities. And I've made it very public that in the 21st century, as we work to put the resources in place to build new infrastructure, to replace and rebuild old infrastructure, that we have a responsibility to build that infrastructure as connective tissue and not as tissue that divides people anymore. That is complicated business. And one critical message I would like to leave you with today is that I sit on top of an agency that has a budget that's greater than $70 billion. We have 55,000 employees across this nation, across the world. But largely what we do is dependent on what local communities and states across this country ask us to do. And if our community isn't at the table asking for what it is we need, that request never gets to Washington. Look across this country at state departments of transportation and the extent to which our communities, Hispanic community, Native American community, look at the extent to which those communities, just by themselves, are represented on these state boards of transportation. That's a table we need to occupy.
See it.
Think about even in your local communities, our metropolitan planning organizations, our city councils, our county commissions, we need to have an idea of how infrastructure is going to make a difference. Congressman talked about the redlining. Well, one of the reasons why I'm not talking about the red line is because we've had two different organizations submit to us complaints under Title VI of the Civil Rights Act in 1964. And so our department is in the process of investigating the actions that the congressman talked about. So it isn't that I'm ignoring that point, it's just that it's a point I can't discuss at this point. But let me say this. One thing is absolutely crystal clear, which is that the community of Baltimore had an idea of how transportation could help them. And if you are living in a community where your community is not having that conversation, you are not at the table. And if you're not on the table, you're on the menu. So, we are using a variety of strategies to raise the visibility of these issues. Back about a year and a half ago, you may have seen these studies that talk about how there are certain cities where income mobility is limited. What they mean by that is that if you are poor, you have less of a chance of achieving a middle-class life in certain places based on where you are born. So I asked my team, I said, what can we do about this? And we looked at this study, we took some of the cities that were at the bottom of the list, Atlanta, Indianapolis, Baton Rouge, Baltimore, Charlotte. We took several of those cities, we went to the mayors of those cities, and we said, is there a transportation project that would make a difference? And in each of those cities, we have projects that we're working with the local leadership on to prove that if you fix the spatial disconnections, you can create more access, more opportunity, more jobs, more connections for people. We are also looking to build a national conversation about this that can be localized. And I want to draw your attention to a leadership academy our department is going to be sponsoring this fall. If you would like to nominate yourself after I've described it to you, you need to let us know this by noon on Monday, September 19th, contacting the following email address, academy@dot.gov. Here's the problem. We say, show up at 9 o'clock a.m. at the government center, and we're going to have a conversation about the new rail project. The first problem is, how many people can show up at 9 o'clock at the government center who have jobs? The second problem is that if you show up, we get into the alphabet soup. There's the EIS, the MPG, the NRC, by the time you're done with it, everybody who's talking to you knows what they're talking about, but no one who's listening knows. So we're trying to figure out a way to demystify the transportation process. So the Leadership Academy is going to walk people through how decisions get made in transportation. Where are the points at which you can make an impact? And what is the language, what are the magic words you can use to help impact? That's what the Leadership Academy is about. So we want people from all over the country to come to our headquarters and have this conversation with us. We're gonna webcast it. We're gonna do regional conversations. And we're building a curriculum that can be taken by organizations, and they can do their own trainings in different parts of the country. But this is how committed we are. We're going high, we're going low, we're going every which way, because I want to make sure that 21st century infrastructure fits a 21st century America, and no matter where you live, there is a project or something that's going to create better access points for you. This is important because besides housing, the second largest expense for most families is transportation. Let me mention one other point, which is that y'all might have heard of this this smart cities competition we just finished back this summer. Smart cities, there's a lot of national and global conversation about smart cities. It's kind of cool and techy. But one of the things we did when we launched it, we had 78 cities apply for it. We got it down to 7 finalists and then picked the winner, which was Columbus, Ohio. Congratulations, I think there's some Columbus people here. But here's one thing I want to point out. Even in this challenge, we were focused on creating a more fulsome conversation about transportation. We asked these cities, not just to tell us what kind of technology they could put together, but how deeply in the community could they place it. And here's something that Columbus came up with. They have a community called Linden within Columbus. In Linden, one of the characteristics of it is that they have 4 times the national average of infant mortality in that one community. It had become a community problem and a national source of embarrassment for Columbus. And we challenged each city to identify problems like this and to help us understand how technology and innovation could help close the gap. Well, Columbus had a brilliant idea to eventually create an app that a mother could use to schedule appointments with her doctor. And the app would actually create a transit trip for her, be paid for at one time. If the bus is late, the appointment gets rescheduled automatically and she gets that note, she knows which bus to catch. And we thought about, well, what if she doesn't have one of these sophisticated smartphones that all of them have? They said, well, we can create kiosks in a neighborhood so that she can have a point of access to the technology that many of us take for granted. You see, we think a smart city isn't just a cool tech city. A smart city is a city in which all of its residents get access to the same thing. That's what it's meant. So we're very proud of that. We're also proud of some of the infrastructure work we're doing. I mention this probably every time I come, but I'm very proud of the work we're doing in Los Angeles with the Crenshaw LAX line, a project that's going into an area that has historically been underserved, but it is now full of life, regenerated by new neighborhood businesses, new housing stock, and people who live in the community working on the project. So our local hire pilot is working and we are going to work to expand on it. We also have been making improvements to our Title VI order. Title VI, as you know, governs the it's a non-discrimination provision of the Civil Rights Act related to the use of federal dollars. The U.S. Department of Transportation has not revised its Title VI guidance for almost 40 years. And we are now in the throes of doing that, and before the end of the year, we will have revised guidance in place. But I think it's fair to say you can expect a more aggressive agency when it comes to the use of federal dollars and ensuring that those dollars are being spent fairly. We are going to continue working to support the expansion and growth of women and minority-owned businesses, ensuring that they are given the tools to be successful. And We want to make sure they're part of the conversation to be awarded contracts for federally funded transportation projects. Our disadvantaged business enterprise program is a resource for minority businesses to turn to when they feel they've been discriminated against. And I'm proud to say that the program has made many improvements since 2013. You may remember that a 2013 audit, I know the congressman remembers, gave us 8 recommendations for the program, and I am pleased to tell you that all the recommendations have now been implemented. We've improved the process for certification and for appeals. This has now eliminated the long backlog of appeals, and we're also making more resources and training available to business owners. And that's yielded results. From 2014 to 2015 alone, we saw nearly a 10% increase in interstate certifications due to these efforts. And in 2015, $4.8 billion out of $39 billion in federally assisted contracts were awarded to disadvantaged business contractors. We also recognize that to truly inspire change, we have to build from the ground up. And that's what I was talking about before. That's why we're doing the Leadership Academy. That's why we did the Ladder Step program. And that's also why we recently did the Every Place Counts Challenge. We picked 4 places across the country where we went, where there were actual physical barriers that the infrastructure created. We're working in 4 communities around the country to get that reversed. The Leadership Academy I mentioned is going to include a toolkit, online resources, and a facilitator to guide aspiring leaders to use and engage their communities and the public on transportation issues. I mentioned this academy, the launch event is going to occur on October 5th, and I hope that many of you, I hope frankly all of you, are glad to be part of the Leadership Academy. The bottom line that I want to leave you with today is that transportation has unfortunately gathered a reputation for being functional. But in fact, transportation is about our communities. It's about how we're connected to each other. It's about how accessible things that we need, like jobs, grocery stores, pharmacies, you name it, are. And the message I want to leave you with here is, if you've done what we have hoped to do, you will go out into your communities and you'll no longer take what you're given. You will start defining for yourselves what you and your community want and need. You will demand it, and you will have voices on the other side of the table who will hear you. Or maybe you'll have some different voices in the future, depending on how much you vote. So anyway, thank you very much. That's what I like to say, not by the way. Thank you.
Mr. Secretary, I just got to do this footnote real quick. I was just telling, I was just telling her why it's important to have diversity and to have people who understand our people and what they go through. This smart city thing, I mean, you think about the things he talked about. If nobody's ever lived near Ms. Bueller and Squeaky and Boujay, they may not understand all of what needs to happen to get people the resources that they need. And I thank you, Mr. Secretary, for not only being sensitive, but creating programs that address those needs so that people can take advantage of them and be informed of it. But you are all of us, don't forget what I said, we're the leaders. Because you know how important transportation is. You know it. And so, not only must you do your jobs, but you need to go back, like you said, to the community meetings. You need to run for office. I'm serious. Be a part of the city council, things of that nature, so that you all can bring that those information resources, just like you bring it to the national level, we need to bring it to the local level. That's all I'm going to say. Thank you, Mr. Secretary.
For that impressive legacy that you left for us to work with. And we're going to move on and progress here at COMTA and work with that legacy. I'd like to just do some housekeeping here. People standing might want to find a chair. I see some open chairs here, and we can make a move to sell those chairs. On the far side, particularly, over here. Oh. Quite a few chairs over here. And this front row will be opening up momentarily. Our next part of the program will be our panel, and that is being moderated by Rhonda Briggs, who is Senior Director of External Affairs for the Metropolitan Atlanta Rapid Transit Authority, MARTA. And of course, once again, the topic will be transportation as a civil right. So we have seats opening up.
Each of the panel members to introduce themselves so that we can save a little time by me reading their long and distinguished bios. I'll just let you all introduce yourselves, but also in your introduction, give us a little bit about your role in transportation. We'll start with Dr. Fidella. Yes, we'll start with you, Dr. Yes. Mm-hmm. You can just from there. Mm-hmm. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Rhonda. And thank you also to Brad Mims from CONTO, President Brad, for inviting me to participate. And I'm honored to be at an event that was hosted by Congressman Elijah Cummings, someone who I've admired for many years. My name is Bella Dinzar, and I come to you today as Vice Chairman of the National Transportation Safety Board, the NTSB. Would you like just to go ahead and tell us all about what we're talking about,
mm-hmm.
All of our remarks, or
okay.
Just
yes.
The initial
question? Well, let's just do the initial, then we'll come back. We'll start with that.
Okay, Michael? Hi, I'm Mike Gardner. I'm Vice President and CDO at the MTA. The MTA is the largest transportation system in the country. And I also want to give a shout out to Brad Benz, Warren and Freddie, and the whole entire council of board, but especially Council of New York. With our president, Frank Messon, sitting here. And I saw the previous presidents, Dwayne Sampson, and also the event for the summer. Thank you.
Good afternoon. I'm Dwayne Callender, director of the credit programs at USDAT. I thank Brad for inviting me. I knew Brad back when he was at USDOT quite a few years ago, so I'm happy to be here this afternoon.
Good afternoon. I'm Barbara McKeo with the Metropolitan Washington Airports Authority. We are the organization that oversees the operation and management of Ronald Reagan Washington National and Dulles International Airport. Hopefully, many of you in the audience have used our facilities traveling to this event the last couple of days. Brad Mims, to me, is many things, including one of my board members, so I appreciate his leadership and the aviation included on this panel, but also the ability to provide great leadership to us as we operate some very significant transportation systems here in Washington.
Hey there, Lucinda Leslie. I've worked for Congressman Cummings for nearly 13 years in a variety of positions. Right now I'm the policy director on the Oversight Committee, members of the Congressional Staff and the Transportation Committee. Prior to Congressman Cummings, I worked on transportation issues for the Maryland and Lucinda.
Thank you. Thank each of you.
Well, the first thing I want to say is thank you so much for inviting me. I've been coming to the Brain Trust every year since I joined Congressman Cummings' office, so that's more than a decade, and frankly, I never expected to be on the list. So I'm amazed and honored. What I wanted to talk about is the view from the Hill. Obviously, under Secretary Fox's leadership, under the President's leadership, a new discussion has begun about the impact of transportation policy on the shape of our communities. You heard him talk about some research and about how place matters. That's actually research by Raj Chetty, and it's something that we were looking at with Congressman Cummings and Senator Warren did the Middle Class Prosperity Project. The research found that childhood spent in a low-income area can have consequences that ripple through a lifetime. For example, growing up in Baltimore reduced a child's earning by 0.7% per year of life in Baltimore. His research confirmed that if you move to areas with opportunities, it makes a difference in a life. And while there are obviously many policies and decisions that shape the places in which we live, transportation is a key part of that policy environment. Something I've noticed in my time working in Congress, including on the Transportation Committee, is that if transportation makes the list of policies needed to create opportunity, it's usually at the bottom of the list. I was struck as I was preparing for this event by an editorial that former Treasury Secretary Larry Summers wrote called Building the Case for Greater Infrastructure Investment. He wrote, and I quote, "The case for infrastructure investment has been strong for a long time, and it gets stronger with the passing year. As government borrowing costs decline and ongoing neglect raises the return on incremental spending increases." In the very next sentence he wrote, "As it becomes clear that growth will not return to pre-financial crisis level on its own, the urgency of policy action rises." Most of the time, if we hear any comment on infrastructure, it's along the lines of what Secretary Summers said in the first comment, that we should invest in infrastructure. Credit is available on good terms. The cost of deferred maintenance is increasing. Sometimes we hear other things thrown into that mix, like transportation investments produce good-paying jobs, jobs that can't be elsewhere. We know all the voters. But the thoughts usually don't get much further than that. Those frames don't appear to be moving policy in Washington. To make sure that transportation is seen as a civil right, we need to take the two in Secretary Summers' editorial, that is, that investment in transportation is good and our economic conditions require new policies, and draw everyone to follow us to a clear conclusion, which is that good investments in infrastructure move everyone forward, economically as well as physically. Good investments create connections, not barriers. And now is the time to begin, as we think about the next highway movement. I know it seems like a long time off, and we just passed the FAST Act. It's going to be around for 5 years. In fact, if recent history is any example, it'll be around for a lot longer than 5 years. But we need to set up now the yardsticks by which we want to measure how good investments are made and what the difference they make for communities by having explicit discussions about the choices that are made in our transportation investments and how they create connections and barriers. I know that you understand the links between our choices and the outcomes. But frankly, not all the policymakers consider those issues from that perspective, and they like to hear that. So I encourage people when you come to the Hill to talk about this issue and make sure that people are aware of how important it is. Only then will the nation's policy dialogue begin with an understanding of adequate and reliable infrastructure, civil rights, which all Americans are entitled to. And I really emphasize this here. we get people to come up and talk about this program or that program, but we need to hear about the importance of decision making and the yardsticks of the one of the measures that we're talking about.
In my opening welcome and introduction, I mentioned that I was pleased to see the aviation sector represented on this important panel conversation, and I sincerely meant that. When you think about all the modes of transportation that are so essential to our economy and to our lives, airports, among all modes of transportation, play an important role for all of us. As an airport operator, of two very significant public facilities here in the Washington area, I just want to spend a couple of moments that I have with you talking a little bit about the economic impact of an airport to a community and why the viability of the airport in the community is so important. And then also speak a little bit about the significance of access and what it really means to have accessibility to air service. So first, from the standpoint of just the economic driver, I think often, I know in my experience in the industry, both in local government and working with the independent authority that's overseeing the operation, often airports can be considered a little bit of an island within a community. Great things happen there. You can get to great destinations and reconnect with family. But in some respects, when it comes to some local decision-making or state policy issues, airports are a little bit off, sometimes off to the side, in terms of they're those entities that just kind of operate onto themselves. And a point that I want to leave with all of you today is how far from the truth that really is. In fact, airports are a significant economic generator to the local communities that they operate in. And very much, there's a great symmetry that is necessary for the success of a local community to take advantage of all that an airport and a community has to offer. Just to give you a few statistics, according to an U.S. Aviation Trade Association study that was done a couple of years ago, back in 2013, airports in the United States generated employment opportunity of over 9 million jobs just in the United States, with a payroll that was in excess of $350 billion, and actually had a GDP production that exceeded $1 trillion. I can tell you here in the Washington region, the two airports that I'm associated with, for this region, we constitute about 4.5% of the GDP that's generated in the greater Washington region. Our airports alone, and I'm not speaking to my employer, but all entities that have an employment nexus to the airports, generate nearly 400,000 jobs just here in the Washington, D.C. area. That's direct, actually at the airport, but more significantly, the indirects in terms of all of the employment opportunities that the existence of the aviation service generates. So very, very significant. And what's important to sustain that is a great partnership with local communities. Obviously, airports depend upon a vast number of employees to actually run the place and make all the moving pieces work, but also rely very heavily on a mutually supportive relationship with the communities that they operate in. Airports make noise, they create traffic, so it's important that airport leaders and airports work very closely with their community to make sure that the access issues are well addressed and that we're existing side by side in the community in a very supportive way with each other. I want to talk a little bit about some of the programs that make airports very successful. In the recent years, with the consolidation that has occurred among the major U.S. airlines, in particular this country, there's a small number of U.S. domestic airlines that are operating. Those that remain have very viable financial balance sheets and very viable, strong networks across the country. But they're very focused on serving large hubs
large communities, and it's important that all communities be serviced, medium and small communities. One program that's accessible to all airports to pursue with their airline partners is the federal government's essential air service. We have several air service routes that are currently supporting Washington Dulles at this time. It's an opportunity for local leaders in every community to work in partnership with their community, with their airport communities, and to partner with airlines to apply for this financial assistance, which the airlines receive that helps really spur a flight to a community that otherwise might not economically generate enough revenue for the airline to be incented on their own to fly the service. And the Essential Air Service Program does serve a very important role of connecting all communities with the air service. Another opportunity that's I know we use a great deal of, and the Secretary referenced it, is the Disadvantaged Business Enterprise Program. Generating revenue at airports through such operations as food and beverage and retail and all the different support services that you see at the airport is a very important part of an airport operator being able to sustain themselves. Most airports across the United States receive very little federal, state, or local funding. They are their own business enterprises to sustain them and generate their own dollars. And I know, like for us here in Washington, they're very proud, those airports are very aggressive in trying to grow the business opportunities for the revenue advantage that that produces to the bottom line to reinvest in the facilities. But equally important to most airports, not all airports in the United States, is to use those concession opportunities to bring the local community into the airports. And you'll see within the airport sector a very aggressive effort to try to include small, local, and really niche-type businesses from the local community in airport concession programs. I want to just, in my final moment, segue into two other points, and that's the access to get there. I think it's critically important for all airport operators to work with their local transportation leaders to make sure that we have transportation access to the airport. Airport operators are responsible for making sure that the air service is available. But we need to partner with the local communities and the transportation officials to make sure we've got the right roadway system, bus system, and transit system to connect the communities to that airport. One example where our organization is pursuing that right now is in the extension of the Washington, D.C. Metro Rail system out from its current Western Point in Virginia out to Dulles Airport and into Loudoun County. Our organization as an airport operator has partnered with the local transportation regions, including the federal government, to together lead the extension of that Metro Rail system out to Dulles. It's good for Dulles Airport in the future, but it's also good for the local communities in terms of providing access between job employment at the airport and the local community. With that, I'll wait and address any issues that the audience may have.
Thank you.
Can you hear me?
Yeah, that's great. Thank you.
I will point out that I'm the director of the credit program within the Bilderberg Bureau. $1.8 billion for the Silver Line project with the local partners, help finance that important project. So the secretary spoke about the importance of being part of the process and planning, behind the seat of the table. My function is to help try to finance these projects. The secretary also created the Build America Bureau back in July, where we consolidated some credit programs within the department to help finance infrastructure projects, transit, highway, rail, passenger rail, port, and airport access, other types of projects. We have about $35 billion available for rail projects, about $3 to $4 billion per year available for highway, transit, and other projects. Typically, we have funded large-scale projects like the Dulles Metro Rail Access Project, Intercounty Connector locally, the Capital Beltway Project. But under changes under the FAST Act, we are actually also focusing on smaller projects. We've lowered the cost thresholds for projects so that communities that don't typically have a $1 billion project or even a $500 million project can access the program for projects as small as $10 million. We are very focused on getting non-traditional borrowers. that have not traditionally accessed the program, both in rural areas, in inner cities. We helped to fund the Crenshaw project that the Secretary mentioned, a project in Denver that's really going to help to connect communities. So I think one important part of the equation is how these projects get financed. As part of the Build America Bureau, we are focused on providing outreach to communities that have not traditionally had relationships with the federal government, gone through financing or haven't actually used financing to advance their projects, so that they know what options we have available, what programs we have available, what financing is available, how to do public-private partnerships, how to combine different sources of funding and financing that we have. Private activity bonds, credit programs, grant programs, also under the Build America Bureau, the Fast Lanes program that was recently enacted under the FAST Act will be in that bureau. And the goal is that we can create packages for specifically tailored to specific programs to help finance them. A lot of the projects that we're looking at are either so large that they require multiple sources of financing and funding, or might be small or not really have a discernible revenue source so that they're not easily financeable in the capital markets. So our goal is to work with sponsors to explore the opportunities that are available. To date, we've had lots of projects in a lot of the major urban areas, so they are projects that impact traditionally disadvantaged communities. But we are also looking to do smaller projects, medium-sized projects in rural areas, other places that have not traditionally had relationships with the federal government, that are not used to either getting federal grant funding or financing. And for programs that are not used to doing P3s, public-private partnerships, where there needs to be a lot more education locally at the state, city level, for the politicians to find champions for these types of projects, because they can take a while. You know, there are lots of projects on the books that are essential projects but have not gone forward because of lack of funding or financing. And I think the Build America Bureau is an opportunity that the Secretary has created to help move those projects along. Projects that people have said, oh, we're gonna put that on the shelf because we don't know how we're gonna get there in terms of funding and financing. We want to talk to those sponsors to help them understand what the department has available, to think outside of the box if they're used to just using pay-as-you-go funding, and think about financing. If they can identify a revenue source to repay some of the credit available within the department, sometimes that financing can be the critical part to get these projects over the hump. We're engaged with a lot of different sponsors, and we've been in the past, from a lot of different communities that have not traditionally taken advantage of the program. To date, we've lent about $25 billion across the nation, heavily invested in large urban areas, but we're also looking to get to other areas that are not traditionally using. Just some quick statistics about the program. We can make loans, lines of credit, loan guarantees available. We're able to lend at treasury rates, which I think is one of the really huge advantages that we bring to some of these projects, where you can get 35 years of fixed financing at rates as low as 2.3% for some of the loans that we've done recently, and at flexible terms. You know, we're really looking to sculpt our financing and funding to the revenue sources available to these projects, and that really acknowledges the fact that a lot of these projects have a very critical public benefits, but might not be projects that produce a lot of revenue. So trying to get creative in ways to move those projects forward. And the Build America Bureau is a place where we're not just financing projects, we're also educating people. We want different communities, project sponsors to come talk to us about our project. Even if they don't think they have a plan of how they would get there in terms of funding and financing, we'd like to engage them because maybe there are things they're not thinking about. Maybe we can put them in touch with other sponsors in other states that have some of the same problems that they have and figure out innovative ways to finance and fund some of the projects. As I mentioned, the Bureau was just stood up in July, but it's taken parts of programs that already existed and trying to improve the process and the efficiency of some of those programs. I think in the past, there's been a thought that, you know, we don't know if we want to deal with the federal government, the process takes too long, it's not that efficient, you federalize everything you touch, so maybe it gets a little bit more expensive. But I think we're trying to both debunk some of those myths and eliminate some of the barriers that we might have internally by better coordinating amongst ourselves so that project sponsors that come and talk to us they're not getting different answers from different modes. You know, if you have a project that is multimodal, has transit elements, rail elements, highway elements, you don't have to go to three different agencies to get three different answers about what the DBE requirements are, what Buy America requirements are, what the NEPA evaluation, a lot of things that can take time and discourage project sponsors from moving forward with the federal government. We really want to unlock the amount of money made available. And I'll say it again, we have $35 billion for rail, $3 to $4 billion under the FAST Act for highway transit, port access. We have a lot of money that we'd like to lend, and prudent money, but to advance transportation. So there are lots of projects that we're willing and looking to be flexible in terms of how we structure the payment profile, how we work with project sponsors that are not used to financing projects, to get to a place where we have a project that we can actually support and put both funding, financing, and some other tools in terms of public-private partnerships, et cetera. So I think with that, I'll turn it over.
All right, thank you. Right now, I'm going to bring the congressman back up, and then we'll proceed.
Excuse me. The in the black church, you always had interruptions. Amen. I am honored to have my colleague from the state of Maryland, and he is the next to Nancy Pelosi. He's number two of all of us Democrats in the Congress. He's our whip, and Steny Hoyer is just a phenomenal human being. I don't know of anyone who is a better strategist than Steny Hoyer. He has been a very, very strong advocate for minority businesses, been a very strong advocate for equity and parity with regard to transportation projects, not only in our state, but throughout the country. And he is the one that spends a phenomenal amount of time trying to come up with the strategies for, even in a House of Representatives that is controlled by Republicans, to get as much as we possibly can back to our districts. And so I'm honored to introduce a friend, and I really mean that, a true friend. Sam and I go all the way back to the Maryland legislature, that's many years. But ladies and gentlemen, the whip, Steny Hoyer, Congressman Steny Hoyer.
Good afternoon, church. I'm so pleased to be here with an extraordinary leader in our country. I don't mean just the Congress, in our country. A person of extraordinary courage and commitment and decency. A person who loves his community. This community had trouble. John Lewis would say bad trouble in this instance. And he walked the streets of his beloved Baltimore and calmed troubled water because they respected him and they knew he was focused on their best interests. I have an agenda that I call Make It in America. Make It in America is what everybody wants their children to do. Make it. Make It America means two things. It means manufacturing, making things, making that microphone, making this bottle, making this podium, making the chairs you're sitting on. But it also means, when we say it colloquially, succeeding. Acing the test, getting the job, winning the game, whatever, high five. And one of the four planks of Make It in America is investing in infrastructure. Because we will not make it in America if we don't invest in our infrastructure. And infrastructure, some people think of it as highways and bridges. And that's true. But if you ask people in Flint what infrastructure is, they won't tell you highways. They will tell you pipes to bring that water to them in a healthy manner. And we haven't done that in Washington, D.C. They were subjected to having their children poisoned with lead by a government decision that said we want to save money. Now, we all want to save money, but we don't want to save money at the risk of human health and life. And this forum is about investing, not spending money. There's a difference between just spending money and investing. When you invest in something, you get something back. When you invest in your children, the best investment we can make in America, you get a lot back. And I want to thank the panelists here. We're talking about investing. Let me say something, I don't know, because you have distinguished panelists here. I'm talking, you're here to listen to them, not to me. In 1993, we passed a small gasoline tax increase. And we keyed it to 1993 prices for asphalt, for concrete, for steel, for other things that you build bridges and roads with. And we haven't changed that in 23 years. How many of you think this bottle cost the same thing in 1993 it cost today? None of us think that. We know that's not the case. Because we buy the bottle and we know that we couldn't buy it today for what we could buy it for in 1993. However, we have refused to invest in infrastructure, roads and bridges in this case, and other infrastructure. We need to invest in the electric grid. You talk about infrastructure as a civil right. You don't have electricity, all our lives are at risk. Our security is at risk with computers. You don't have an electric grid that works. So you're here trying to raise the consciousness of our country that used to be absolutely unrivaled in terms of the quality of its infrastructure 30 years ago. Period. America was it. Those of you who travel, I know a lot of you travel to other countries, and you see their infrastructure, you see their rail cars, their high-speed trains, their commuter transportation, and you see it recently built, recently rebuilt, very efficient and effective. And they're our competitors. And to the extent that they can compete better, your kids and my kids, I have three children, I have three grandchildren, I have three grandchildren. I want their country to be competitive. So what you're talking about today is absolutely critical. Whether it's the water pipes in Flint, sewer systems in my county, the roads and the bridges, the electric grid, whatever it is, we need to raise consciousness of Americans that we need to get our infrastructure up to speed if we're going to make it in America. I want to thank Elijah Cummings, one of the great leaders on the infrastructure committee. And I saw the title of this as a civil right. What does that mean? I can see you from the bridge, whatever. But the concept is very clear. If we don't have good public transportation, if we don't have good roads, let me tell you who suffers the most. Those who are absolutely dependent upon those public investments. You know, some people may be able to take care of themselves and have their own plane and ride around America. try to get somebody in mind and make you do it. But most of us can't do it. Most of us rely on our collective investment in making the quality of our communities better. We we need in the Congress of the United States all of you who are all influential in your community. Not just in the black community, I mean in your community writ large, in your country writ large. This is the most effective legislative conference at any point in time in any year in Washington, D.C. And the most focused like a laser on the real issues that confront our country. So I thank you for being here. I thank you for what you do at home. And I urge you to take this message that America is right now the greatest country on the face of the earth. I mean, whatever your enterprise, whatever you do, you may well get up and say, my business, my job, my school, my team, or whatever is the greatest, but I can make it greater. I can make it better. I can make it more efficient. I can make it more fair and more just.
Yes.
That's what our fellow citizens ought to expect of us, and that's what we ought to expect of us as well. God bless you. Thank you very much.
Laid out $100 billion in infrastructure projects that's currently going on in New York City right now. And what does that mean for the MTA? The MTA is a gigantic beast. We serve 5,000 miles. We have 70,000 employees. We purchase $6 billion in contracts per year. But we do everything big, but government needs to be obligated to not only spend taxpayers' dollars in a cost-effective manner, but in an inclusive manner as well. And we started viewing the landscape and seeing how MWDB firms were not getting contracts. And we said, we gotta change that. Because government has failed historically, because we meet you at forums like this, we take you through an arduous certification process, we bring you back in, and you can't work. Because we have not focused on the barriers to entry. Now, what are those barriers to entry? Lack of access to capital, lack of access to bonding, lack of access to the right size contract. And so the MWDBE goal setting process is important, but we need to focus on designing projects that will allow emerging MWDBE firms to bid on our projects as prime contractors and consultants. Because the reason is because if we allow you to compete and you are awarded contracts, prime contracts, you are then in control of your own destiny for your own growth. And so far oftentimes you hear agencies say that all sounds good, but it's in violation of state law. So what should your next response be? Change the law. And so we created a program that's called the Small Business Mentoring Program. I have a few pamphlets. And what this program does, and we've already allocated over the next 5 years, 430 projects totaling $501 million so that those 230 pre-qualified MWDB firms can bid in this program against each other. So we are investing in our MWDBEs because we know that it's cost effective for us to invest and not view it as an expense, because the more firms, the more contractors you have bidding on your work means what? There's a downward spiral on pricing. And so our new $30 billion capital program We are partnering with Council New York, Council National, and the FTA, because the FTA is the largest recipient of FTA funding in the country. And so we're having a DBE Opportunity Day in the city of New York being hosted by the MTA. Once again, in association with Council New York, Council National, and the FTA. Because we want to not only tell you what projects we have that's going to be awarded of that $30 billion, just over the next 12 months, we're going to be awarding $6 billion in projects. But we want to better be able to integrate you in our processes to make sure that at the end of the day, contracts that's paid for by taxpayers' dollars are not only being spent cost effectively, but inclusive of our pool of emerging MWDB firms. Thank you.
Good afternoon, everyone. It's really an honor to be here with all of you at COMTO and the CBC Foundation. I've always wanted to come to this event, and I'm honored to have been invited. I'm here as the vice chairman of the NTSB, but I'm also here as a public health scientist. And it may seem unexpected for someone trained in public health to be vice chairman of the National Transportation Safety Board, but it actually makes perfect sense. Some people would think that it seems unexpected that transportation would be considered a civil right, but we know that makes perfect sense too. In transportation, it makes perfect sense if we remember that motor vehicle crashes are the number one cause of death for people in this country. And it's the leading cause of death for young people. And like a lot of risks to our health, people of color are at great risk. We can't believe that transportation is a civil right if we don't also believe that transportation safety is a civil right. In public health, we often focus on the most vulnerable populations who have the greatest risk, because that's a way that we can have the greatest impact on the health of a community. In transportation safety, for example, pedestrians are at higher risk. Bicyclists continue to be at risk. People of color are at greater risk. Low-income communities are at greater risk. As many of you know, at the NTSB, we're unique because we are a completely independent federal agency. We're independent of the US DOT. We have one single mission, and that's to advance transportation safety. We're charged by Congress to investigate every civil aviation accident, and you often see us probably on TV in your communities after a terrible crash that I myself have often attended. But we also investigate highway accidents and marine accidents and pipeline and hazardous materials and train accidents. We take these accident investigations very seriously, and we take the loss of life in any mode of transportation very seriously. And we're fortunate that in aviation, we made great advances. So you probably haven't heard of very many commercial minor deaths in our country, and that's because of the work that all of us in transportation have been doing. But of all the modes of transportation, year in and year out, the greatest number of deaths still occur on our roads. And surface transportation is also how primarily Americans get to work, get to school, access their health care, go to recreation areas, all such important factors in our health and our quality of life. As Americans, you know we value freedom, and this includes freedom of transportation, freedom to get around in many different ways. So our job at the NTSB is to help you do that in whatever way you want to do it, but to do it as safely as possible. That means walking, riding a bicycle, driving a car, taking public transportation, all important forms of transportation. And we want you to know we're here to help make those forms as safe as possible. In public health, we often speak of a term called social determinants of health. And many of you are probably familiar with that. Things like housing, education, food security, water, security infrastructure. Transportation is the cornerstone of all of these determinants of health, if we really think about it. As you understand more than anyone, it's not just about transportation to access what one needs to maintain health and well-being, such as a hospital or a clinic, but it's having safe and reliable transportation to get there. Lack of safe and reliable transportation is a social injustice because it affects all of our priority issues. It affects our civil rights. We have to incorporate this culture of transportation safety into all of our issue priorities. And that's what I'm asking you to do. For example, what good is a community health clinic if you can't get there safely and reliably? What good is a school if there are no safe sidewalks and crosswalks for children to get to that school? What good is a park where families can get together if the families have no way of getting there safely? We're at a crossroads in transportation safety, and this is an important time for us to stand together. Recently, Secretary Fox released national data, FARS, the Fatality Analysis Reporting System, on road deaths this month. So let's look at the statistics a little bit. We now face the highest annual percentage increase in highway deaths in nearly 50 years. Unfortunately, this past year, we saw a 7% increase in deaths when we've been on a downward trend. This is more than 30,000 deaths in our country every year. That's an epidemic. There are a lot of reasons for this increase, but a lot of the reasons that we see are ones that we've grappled with for many years. That's why we need to include transportation safety in everything we do, to better our communities. We cannot have a safe, educated, happy community without having safe transportation. So for over 25 years, the NTSB has issued a most wanted list of transportation priorities. These are 10 issues covering all the modes of transportation that have a chance of being advanced if it's given a good hard push by the NTSB and our colleagues like yourselves. Issues like high-risk routes such as distracted drowsing, impaired drivers. These are issues that make us remember why it's important to remember that tools such as public transportation are not just an accessibility tool, but it's actually a safety tool because it can help keep high-risk drivers out of the driver's seat. We can remember that the 10,000 people who died in alcohol-related crashes could have been kept out of the driver's seat if we had separated drinking from driving. An example is good public transportation infrastructure is a way to do that. So we have to stand together. And all of us here today, all of you with the Brain Trust, play an important role in advocating for transportation as a civil right. We know we can do this because we've done this before. Our country has stood together before and saved lives. We've stood together advocating for child passenger safety, for graduated driver's licensing, for primary seatbelt laws, for impaired driving laws. And we can do this again. As Congressman Hoyer said, we need to invest in safety. That's investing time and money. So just to end this, before I was at the NTSB, I worked for an international philanthropy that worked with the United Nations. And I had the honor of working with the family of the late President Nelson Mandela in South Africa. President Mandela believed in road safety as a human right because it provided access to education. And frankly, he was tired of seeing so many African children dying on their way to school. They were dying on the roads, being run over. They were literally dying for an education. So I'm proud to have worked with his grandchildren, Zilega Mandela and Kwaku Mandela, for many years before I was in this position, to prevent more loss of life in Africa, but around the world. So transportation is a civil right, but we should remember it is a human right as well. And we must do everything we can to ensure that everyone has access to this right. Thank you.
Before we open up the floor for questions, I do have two things I want to do really quickly. And that is, Margaret, When we're talking about transportation and civil rights, we're looking at this in two ways. Well, we can look at it in two ways, so access and opportunity. So in the space of opportunities, because we have so many of our DBEs in the audience, how do we at the airports really go deep in making sure that those dollars are being equally accessible to our DBEs?
Well, first, through the DBE program, I meant what I mentioned earlier in my comments. Although there's a requirement for airports to participate in the DBE program, the real value goes well beyond that regulatory requirement or any financial results. Airports across this country are incredibly committed to distinguishing themselves. Communities recognize that sometimes the airport's the first appearance for a community, for a particular visitor, and it's the last impression for a visitor as well. So, in particular, airports are very, very interested in working with small and niche and unique businesses from the local community. So I would encourage DBEs to not only represent themselves in terms of the regulatory compliance of the federal program, but to uniquely communicate to the airports that you're interacting with the unique opportunities you represent in terms of bringing local business into the community. Another program that I'll cite, in addition to the federal DBE program, we in Washington have a local business participation program. Every single procurement offering that we put out, every time we look to procure goods and services, we actually have review every procurement for involvement of local business community at our expense side of the house. That's kind of a program. It's not all that unique to Washington. Each airport has its own custom variation of a program like that. But I think it's very important for you, first of all, to get engaged with the professionals at the airport who are overseeing these kinds of programs and be familiar with the networking events they do in their community, because I often emphasize that the opportunities need to be pursued long before when the procurement gets put on the website or the public offering begins. You're already kind of behind in that regard. So get to know who the local leaders are at your respective airports, get to know what their spend is, get to know what their cycle is in putting out their contracting opportunities, and get in the door and talk and visit with them and participate in their various workshops that they have to promote their opportunities.
Thank you. I have one for you, Lucinda. We come up to do on the Hill visits, and as a congressional staffer, what can we do better in making sure our messages is coming across? If we're talking about civil rights, transition civil rights issues, what do we need to do as council, as individuals, to really make sure we're advancing the ball?
Thank you. I appreciated what he had to say, which is, the law is not clicking. What you think is the priority to change the law. I can't begin to build on what the Secretary said, what Congressman Cummings said, what Congressman Hoyer said, except to say that they are, the dialogue that has begun at the DOT and the focus that is now being placed by the DOT on those issues needs to be reflected in the policy and in the laws that we adopt. The FAST Act comes out, or Safety Lou, or MAP 21, it's talking about this program or that program. It has a few metrics. They are generally not metrics about how the investment is improving mobility and creating opportunity and creating those connections. So we need to look again to the next bill, and it sounds like it's a long time away, but it's not. We need to be developing policy positions that are very specific, because bills are about provisions, and advocating for those provisions, what you want to see in the next bill and how that bill should reflect the priorities we've been talking about today. Because if those priorities are not reflected in the policies, not reflected in the law, it's dependent on specific actions of agencies and the DOT to make sure that they are considered when investment decisions are made. So this is a long-term effort, and I think it's one that members and staff need to hear. I mean, it's fine to come in and talk about this program, that program, this money, that money. Right now there isn't a lot of money. Perhaps that'll change, perhaps it'll change if the composition of the Congress changes. But it's really about talking the policy. What are we going to do with the money, and how do we know that the money expenditure reflects what we think is important for communities and for the nation.
Thank you. With the 50-year-old program, can you give us a success story out of that? How a city or a county really took those funds and this and really successful?
As I mentioned, the Build America Bureau's goal is to unlock the resources that we have to make sure that we're not losing money on the table, that we are trying to get to as many projects and advance as many projects as possible. The one success story is in Denver, where we made a loan both under the RIF program and the GIFT program for Denver Union Station, which that project helped to spur a lot of development around that station, jobs, real estate, commercial, etc. If you go there now, you see the visual that they had at the time, and they're making it better. That the money is repaying itself a thousandfold, both in terms of jobs and investment in the community, but also access for the people in the community and other communities. And I think we're trying to replicate that around the country. We have, when the program first started, just Tipia, we did a lot of highway projects, but have done a lot more transit projects about mobility, access, a lot of the things that a lot of people on this panel, as well as some of the other speakers, talked about.
Thank you. Okay, now we're going to give you all an opportunity to ask the panel some questions. We have about 15 minutes, so ask your questions so we can get a lot of questions in. Yes, ma'am.
Good afternoon. My name is Deborah Thompson. I'm with the National Association of Black Women in Construction. And I would like to speak to the aviation side for the local and the Federal Aviation Authority. In the procurement and purchasing processes, a lot of times our small businesses, even if they're DBEs or if they're in an ABA program, it's hard for the general public to distinguish when you're doing procurement opportunities, which one's for FAA and which one is for your local aviation authority. Can you speak to how you go into the community and try to alert the local community? Because if you're not in a specific ABA program, you don't know what there is out to look for those opportunities, but they're still at your local agency.
The
second question is to the gentleman with the New York on the bonding. Bonding and financing are so closely akin that a lot of times our DBEs, if they do bond the project for $3 million, then they don't have mobilization or the money to carry on the project. So what kinds of things are in place so that if a person is bonding and financing a project at the same time that they're so looking?
First, on the procurement side, all of our procurements are on our website, mwaa.com, so we have a very transparent procurement page for all the states, not just those that are currently active, but those that are also forecasted to come out. But more than on a periodic basis, we actually forecast everything that's coming down the pipe for us for the next 12 months to 18 months. And we publish to the community that forecast so that you can take a look at what's coming well before it actually presents itself. And we have a network with all of the local chambers of commerce, local governments. As an independent entity, we partner with a lot of the local governments and chambers of commerce and small business associations whenever they do procurement fairs or job fairs. We're there. That's a great avenue for us. We certainly do the traditional of putting ads out in various newspapers and publications and trade press for our larger construction, but the more routine is really forecasting 12 to 18 months ahead of time and making sure all of the regional agencies that represent different business interests have access to that to promote with us. And then we do a number of exhibit fairs and fairs ourselves outside of the airport as well.
And that's both with the on both sides, federal and your local?
Absolutely. To us, it's agnostic as to what the funding source is. We have an aggressive outreach program to the local community for both the revenue side, the concession producing contracts, but also for the expense side when we're procuring goods and services. And that same outreach is agnostic to what the particular source of funds may be, the federal program or our own dollars.
Thank you.
So, access to bonding and capital is still a national issue with regard to MWDEs. So what we've done is that in this specialized program that we have, we've hired the nation's largest black bank, Carver, which is Savings Bank in Harlem. And under this arrangement, Carver has the ability to issue loans up to $900,000 per contract for firms doing business in this program. And almost like a two-party check system. So the contractor has to take out a checking account. Once the invoice is submitted to us, the proceeds of that invoice is wired over to Carver. Carver has 48 hours to take out their proceeds and then issue the balance to the contractor. So we're forcing our MWDBs to become bankable in this program.
So the training is along with that, so they understand, along with the actual access?
We have a 13-week mandatory training program. Every firm that we pre-qualify this program must take the mandatory 13-week training program in order to bid in this special set-aside program that we have. And as I indicated earlier, there's 432 projects totaling $501 million over the next 5 years that we've allocated to this specialized set-aside program.
So if the person has assigned his assets to a bond,
okay,
get the bond.
Right.
And then, so is Carver going to work with that individual? Because now we don't have anything to collateralize the project. Is it based on basically the contract?
So in the 4 years of this program, a firm's tenure 4 years, we waive bonding. And we waive bonding by creating an internal bond program. So we have taken funding and we have set it aside. So it's almost like owner's control is short for OSIP. So if you're bondless, we'll wrap you up for the 4 years that you're in the program. But we're not doing you a favor. So we've hired Bullets and they have been incorporated into this training program. And they're teaching you how to become bondless.
Because my experience shows that the bondless is a key asset for a person who from a subcontracting position. Prime contractor,
you waive the bond, but you never get into the process of knowing and understanding
what that whole continuum
and formula is. Exactly. So sometimes we need to make sure that they know and understand that it's not going away. Okay, so we're
going
to allow the two of you immediately
after this.
You have a question?
No.
Who has a question?
She's bonding.
Joanne Brooks,
sure.
Bonding.
Oh, you can
go see Joanne. Yes.
Right.
Any questions?
Here we go. Hi, my name is Diane Babineau. I'm from the International Association of Machinists and Aerospace Workers. I noticed on the panel that you never talked about young people, about skill training, maybe bringing some of the children back into the high schools or something like that. For example, like, we have a lot of members that's retired from out of that industry. And so we need to have skill and training. So, you know, it's not like that same books. So it would be nice to see some young people not only flying, but buying the training, saying that they're young people.
So, yeah, I can speak to that. Okay. So we have a procurement on the street right now with 1,500 subway cars. It's going to be in excess of $3 billion procurement. We partnered with this association called Jobs Across America. And so, if you understand New York City, the Fortune 500 capital of the world is Manhattan. If you go to the South Bronx, third poorest county in the country. And so, this 1,500 subway car procurement is going to be linked to whichever manufacturer wins this project. There, they are going to have to implement a training program for unemployed, underemployed residents that's going to lead to jobs at that manufacturing plant. So taxpayers' monies funding subway cars, jobs being created, is a win-win for everyone.
Yes, my name is Eric Johnson, Cleveland, Ohio. And one of the concerns I have is that in this era of limited funding, states, localized transit agencies, we need support externally and to apply pressure to our state organizations that aren't funding public transit systems adequately. Regardless of whatever DBE or MBE or whatever program you have, if the agencies aren't receiving the proper amount of funding to support the projects and processes that they're engaged in the simple operation, you know, it's going to be a moot point. So we really need leadership in D.C. to exert force, some kind of legislative policy that brings state transit DOTs into a process that says we must fund public transit with regards to this being a civil right. It has to be funded properly. So where are you on that? It's just a concern that we're not talking about it. Someone has to start talking about it because it's not even, I understand we're on the DBE process and that end of it, but if we don't get this part of the process together, we're not going to be talking about that at all.
I think that's absolutely correct. I think so much focus, and we had this discussion about the red line, is about new construction. Where is the construction going? And that's a critical question. But to treat transportation as a civil right, it also must include maintenance funding. And you see this, as the federal funds have cut back, the states have not stepped up to fill in the buckets. And that's, again, those are the kind of issues that people aren't seeing up here. You know, they aren't seeing the consequences of austerity, even when it's happening to the Washington Metro. That is actually within the jurisdiction of our committee. We have multiple hearings. There isn't a lot of acknowledgement of the consequences of underinvestment. But it's critical, like, again, this message, when people come up, they have to see the entire continuum of transportation as that civil right issue. It's no good if you just build it and then it falls apart. It's no good if you just build it and then it's not safe to use, or the fares have to be raised so high that it's not affordable. It has to be that full continuum.
Thank you. We have one more question.
My name is Gerard Anthony Morris from Hamlet, North Carolina, the co-chairman of Music Edutainment. That's what we do. Communication, community issues, logistics and supply chain, major. Historic preservation societies as a tool for prevention of gentrification. Also, case studies and textbooks. Like when we talk about the cases that you all have been through, where are these cases and how do we go about making sure they're put in these textbooks so that we are educating our folks and also promoting the Black business aspect, the Black experience aspect, as well as being able to use that as a significant teacher tool. I appreciate what you said about Mandela's grandchildren, as far as one of the students who were born in the school died for education. And was right here. I'm from Hamlet where the chicken fire happened. Imperial Foods, that guy did 4 years out of a 20-year sentence. So how do we inculcate these type of things or implement them inside the institutions?
Government
and private.
Agencies are spending taxpayers' dollars, and those taxpayers' dollars are not being inclusive. That's why CompTIA has to be strong in working with Congress to make sure that if agencies are not awarding contracts in an inclusive manner, that they come up with programs that will allow them to do so.
Dr. Tizella Zendar was one of our women who moved the nation on Rees this year. So thank you for coming back today. Excellent panel, right?
Yes.
Yes. So I'm going to thank you all. I'm going to turn it back over to Renee, and she's going to close us out. Thank you.
I'd actually like to recognize Warren and Brad. Would you like to address the audience before we close out completely?
Good afternoon.
Good
I want to also thank the panel. I want to thank Congressman Cummings and Congressman Boyer, more especially the Secretary for coming and spending time with us this afternoon. It's so awesome that we hear and get opportunities to listen to our legislators, listen to those folks who are the movers and shakers, but more importantly, those of you in this audience, as they said, you are the ones, and we are the ones in our communities that's going to make Congress and the other folks do what needs to get done. So again, I thank you all for being here. At this time, I would like to have our board stand up again so everyone can see who this, our new board is. For a lot of good work out of this board and also Brad Mills. And thank you for being here. Thank you all. Have a good day.
As we close out, I don't want to get a benediction quite yet, but as we close out, I want to make a personal appeal. I've just been afforded the privilege of serving as the interim president of COMTO. As COMTO is moving forward, if you've heard me say, as COMTO is moving forward, we are going to grow. We're going to deal with issues of intermodalism as we go forward. As you guys know, we've been largely a transit-oriented entity, but there's so many other aspects of it, as you've heard today, of our transportation community. And I want to make sure that as we grow as a global mobile global mobile community. And so I ask for each and everyone's help here in the audience. Get the word out, let them know what we do, and ask for their help in making sure that as we move further into the 21st century, that we do what we do. I'd like to thank our panel today for your contributions, and I just ask you to have a wonderful CBCF. And we look forward to seeing you soon. So thank you.
Thank you.